second part to deal with the growth of tissue. So we are moving to more mammalian cells, question more related to medicine, and the challenge that are showing.
Okay, so we are moving now to medicines and the challenge that are offered to us to create systems that are resembling what is inside your body. So we are now after the goal of creating what we call micro tissues and to make them as similar as they are into your body, such we can manipulate them, we can make studies, we can understand how cancer cells grow, how they invade other tissue, we can make competition assay and so on and so on. So it's a big deal today. What and how can we make these tissues on a large scale with a very large throughput rate, with a very reliable methods? It's an open game for all of us, and this has started really seriously. I heard recently that the culture cell business in the biotech world is the most, is a bigger one. So life technology, just I met someone who told me it's an exploding business, and everything related to making this three-dimensional tissue will make the jackpot in a few years. So everybody should think about that. Okay, so as usually when we start something, we always want to have some motivation. So there is many motivation for that. So of course we want to make a micro tissue to understand, for example, how they behave in front of healthy tissue, for example, for cancer cell. We want to know how the mechanical stress on this tissue is affecting their phenotype. But also we want to make them just to use them for answering all these challenges. And as you see, when you want to make all the way down from the discovery to the therapeutic really use of this molecule, you have to go through these different steps. And there is a step which is quite of a problem today, all the use of animal models, where you have to make what they call xenograft into animal to see how then the toxicity can be tested. And so this is a problem today. So if we can shortcut all that by making this 3D culture system, this will speed up, of course, the flow from discovery to use. Okay, this is one of the important motivation. All right, so. So a word about who were the hero of that. So there is two guys, PhD, Hugo and Kevin for the biology side, and Hugo for the material science side, who were very, very brilliant. It's a very strong collaboration also between our colleague at Institut Curie in Paris, it's nearby our institute, and Pierre Nassois is leading the group, and he was very active to bring together the material science I'm going to explain to you and the biology that works together. Okay, so as a slight introduction, I want to tell what was done previously. Of course, this question was addressed long ago, and previously people have been doing this quite crazy technology that I'm going to show you. So what you have to understand is to make these cells growing and making tissue the same way they are doing in your body, they need to feel the same environment. So this is something you have to get in mind. If they don't feel comfortable, if don't feel the same chemical surroundings, the same signalization flux towards them, they don't express the right phenotype, and they somewhere differentiate to something else. And the cell you have and the cell you consider are not going to respond to any of the action you are imposing to them the way they should if they were coming from a real 3D material system. So the way people were thinking about doing it was, this is quite cute, it's called the hanging drop method. So if you let this drop stick on the wall here, like when you take a shower, you know, there's little drops stick on the wall. In the cavity of this drop, the cell feel comfortable. So you have to consider you are one of the cells, and you sit on this interface. The interface is very smooth, and the elastic response of this surface is similar to your resistance, to the resistance of the cell, and there is a sort of collaboration that makes that the tissue start to grow properly. But you know, it's very difficult to parallelize, it's a 2D system, but people have been quite well working with this method. It's commercial. Life Technology Service. It's basically plates, and you have a little drop which is hanging behind the hole, and you have to see the cell on the top, so it's not very convenient, you must admit it. Okay, but there is a large array of work already done on that. Another technique which were discovered about a few years ago, something like 2010, consisting, and that again you will see how delicate this type of growth is, consisting seeding the cell with some very small nanomaterial, magnetic nanomaterial. I saw one of the mechanical property, chemical property, and of course the chemical environment, all the time-dependent environment. So far we know. And this is very much depending also on the type of cell. If there are stem cells, it's even more subtle, so et cetera, et cetera. By seeding this cell with some nanomaterial, magnetic one, you see that then you can use a gradient field to levitate these cells towards the surface again, and then you make them filling the surface, and again it's the same thing, you reverse gravity, but you are sort of hanging drop acting here on that surface. And this has been working, but again it's far from being a high throughput production and it's not very reproducible. Okay, so then that's the introduction. We have to come up with something else, something that works well, fast, cheap, reliable. All right, so when you start to do something reliable, cheap, and so on, better to take products that are biocompatible right from the start, that are commercial, and so on. So one of these materials that all of you know probably are hydrogels. Is everyone knows what are hydrogels here? You know? No, yes, I do. But I hope everybody knows more or less. If, okay, maybe. So I will say a word about that. So hydrogel are natural materials. They are polysaccharide. And they are random copolymer made out of two blocks, the blocks M and G. So they don't have exactly the same structure. If you look at the, it's a sugar ring, but you know, the stereochemistry is slightly different. I don't want to go into all these details. But it's a natural product, and it's extracted from a marine algae, not plankton, the plants. And there is different marine algae that you can use, and the grade of this alginate is different. It's quite a large business, and it's used in many, many fields already. Probably you know that it's used as implants to deliver some drugs because it's biocompatible. It's used now to build up some scaffold for reconstructed tissue, and so. So that's why they made it biocompatible, and they made it also autoclave, so you can buy it without any concern. Okay, so how does it work? If you add calcium to this molecule, you see that you have carboxylic group here, and all these groups are ready to make ionic bonds with calcium divalent ion, and it's just a result. If you add calcium into this polymer solution, it precipitates into a gel. But it's a subtle transition because you could think it's a mixture between precipitation of a salt and also precipitation of the polymer. You don't know what is precipitating at the end. But the result is this bridge, these bonds here, are building a network, and you end up with a very open gel, which is essentially water, because you have only 2% of polymer into it, but even less, you can go to 1.5%, up to 3-4, above is too viscous, so you cannot process it. And typically, that's the image you can get from a TEM, you know, it's a very classical picture of a random gel with some mesh size, of course, but...
What's the scale part?
This is typically 10 microns size hole here.
10
nanometers, sorry. You were afraid. No. Okay, so I think I gave you enough of the pictures. The model of the binding here is what they call the egg box. So the calcium is complexed by four of this carboxylic group, and the egg box are chaining like this, so it's quite a complex structure. It's still debated, to be honest. But it's so useful that we should make something with it. Okay. So a bit of thermodynamic, just a slight amount because we need it. So if you plot the amount here of the calcium chloride concentration as a function of citrate, why citrate? Because citrate is competing with calcium for complexation. In other words, if you add citrate into this gel, the gel must dissolve. So it's another beautiful advantage of this hydrogel. If you don't put these skeleton ions, citrate or phosphate or so on, they last forever, even in pure water. I mean, it's not reversible in terms of thermodynamics. You have to wait very, very long. But if you put citrate or phosphate, then you turn in a few seconds, few minutes, it's totally dissolved. So this is a thermodynamic diagram. You see, if there is too much of citrate, it's a viscous liquid. Then if you reduce the amount, you go into a zone where it's a soft gel plus viscous liquid. Then you enter into the soft gel that occupies the entire space. And then you end up with a zone where the gel is contract and the water is expelled. So there is a coexistence between the top gel and the water. And this is it's easy to understand. It's really following what we call the product of solubility. Basically, this transition is really governed by a product of solubility, like you all know about precipitation of calcium sulfate or whatever. That's fine for everyone here? Okay. But the interesting thing, which is important for us, is if you change the ionic strength of your solution, you are not changing the thermodynamic. Zero change. You can put more salt, as long as it is and monovalent ion, minus plus, like sodium chloride, the transition as a function of calcium chloride are absolutely maintained at the same position. You have the same zone and so on. There is only one change that occurs if you put salt, is the rate at which the polymer will dissolve. That's the only thing which is going to change. And this is very funny. If you take this gel, piece of gel, you put this into a pure, infinite volume of water, the gel is going to last for probably all of your life. But now if you put salt, sodium chloride, then it will dissolve much faster. So is there anyone who understands that? Me, it took a few years, I would say, to really understand that. But somewhere it's the same thing as if you take a piece of rocks, same argument, take a piece of rocks, and you put that in an infinite amount of water, like the ocean, and the dissolution is very slow. Though the entropy must be infinite for the ion if they get dissolved. All right, so it's just a question of energy barrier, and the energy barrier is much reduced if you put iron into it, because when you take the calcium out, like a ratchet mechanism, when you take out, ions can go there and lower the energy barrier. It's extraordinarily efficient. And we did that experiment. So we did that on our material I'm going to describe in a few minutes. So it's with our capsule and so on. And we were measuring the time it takes for this capsule to burst as a function of salt concentration. And we find that it is extremely sensitive to the ionic strength, with absolutely a straight line over many, many decades, saying that the time it takes for dissolving at least one piece that gives rise to the burst is scaling linearly with this function 1 over I if you take the log. So I'm sure we can explain that, but so far we were not able to. So just to see probably with some interesting electrostatic repulsion into the energy, into the barrier between the ion, but we don't really get the point so far. Okay, so you understand. You have a gel, easy to make, it's forever. It can be dissolved if you put the right recipe, so to lower the energy barrier. And we know the numbers that are required to make a top gel. Okay, let's go. So if you want to make these capsules, the first things to do is just to take the simplest way. So you say, I'm going to co-flow a solution that is going to contain whatever you want, ultimately cells. I will co-flow another layer that contains the polymer, a 1 or 2% of the alginate here, and I will enter the dripping regime, and I will hope that this stuff is going to fall down into the calcium, polymerize, you take it out, and you have a very thin reproducible membrane. So that's your dream, okay? And if you look at this picture, I show you that the dream is true, but
so
I will...
Everything is water,
sir. That's the beauty of it. You drip water into water, and you want to maintain the multilayer. It has to happen very quickly. It's even more than that. I will explain you in a few slides. You'll see. So, when everything works, that's what you expect. You drip, or you jet. I will show you the different ways. And you hit the calcium, puff, and you make a fabulous capsule. And the capsule will have 5 to 10 micron thick, totally homogeneous, with a core that contains whatever you want. And the beauty of it is there is no shear, there is no damage to the cell because you are flowing through the air, so there is no shear into the air. The only thing which is happening is the impact on the liquid, but this we can set and manage that too. Okay, so probably you want to know how we do it. Yeah, there is a little bit of, but I will show you a little bit of, I don't know how you say it in English. Huh?
Dimple.
Dimple. Yeah, we can reduce this, I will show you.
Is it dimple or a cut?
No, there is an excess of alginate on the, on, at the pole.
Is this generic control
or is it possible to... No, we can, show you if we reduce the size, if we go to the jetting mode, this disappears. Okay, now we have some nice movie done by Nicolas Bremond, his colleague of Denis. Where is Denis? Denis, there. So they are the artist of the high-speed camera. You can capture everything you want. So he was telling me that he has been doing a piece of art with popcorn blowing up with a high-speed camera. Denis, that's a brilliant idea. So I will show you what we can do with this type of instrument. So, what's going on when you drip a drop of water into water and you just put salt, calcium salt into the bath so you have a refractive index contrast and you see it very well. This is what happened. Okay, you see the crateria on the top and you see the drop that is slowly mixing toward chaos into the calcium solution. So, nothing surprising if you drip a drop into a solution, if everything is miscible, you kill everything, all right? Okay, now I will show you the discovery. A discovery done by chance, you know, because you, one time, one of the students didn't clean up a vial properly, and something was happening, and it took several months to really understand why it was working, and then we said, maybe there is trace of something that makes a drop. I will show you. Now we are going to drip a drop of water into calcium, but we add into the drop of water something like less than the CMC concentration of a surfactant. Everybody knows the CMC?
So this is just the calcium water?
This is pure water into a calcium water solution. Now I will do water plus traces of that surfactant dripping into calcium solution, okay? Traces, something like 10 to the minus 3 mole per liter, absolutely zero. What is left if you don't clean up the vial, basically. That's what's happened. Okay, add surfactant about CMC or less. I let you discover. I'm always impressed with this, so I like to share that with you. What do you see? Oh, look at the time scale here. And look at that. Absolutely no mixing up until at least a tenth of a second. That's absolutely spectacular, and it took a while for us to understand that. But if you can protect transmission of all the turbulences, vortices, and so on into the drop, then you're in business for the calcium to diffuse, make the membrane, and then take it out. Okay? In addition, you can make a multi-co-flow, so it might be one layer, another layer, multi-layer, so you can play as much as you want to decorate the inside of the capsule, to have a vanescent layer of something in order to protect very fragile stem cell, and so on. Okay, so is anyone here having a clue about why this is working? Maybe Paul, he had that talk several times. You know. Is anyone having an idea what's going on here? Traces of surfactants, it totally changes the way the drop impacts the water.
Surface tension
is lower because you had surfactant. And there is no surface tension between water and water. So,
what if you add polymer or anything else?
Into the water? That doesn't work. It's a water soluble surfactant, of course. I add something to you. The surfactant has to be unsoluble into the bath. One more clue, so you are very good. It's warming up now. So it has to be insoluble into the bath. So you are below the craft point to talk as a chemist. So your soap will be
below what
kind of extent? The craft temperature.
Craft
temperature. But
K-R-I-F-S.
What? So it's not terrible. So then I will tell you. I will tell you the scenario.
One question: how long do you cook to understand?
To understand that?
Yeah.
I would say to be convinced it took a year.
Okay, so you cannot.
No, no, no. But to get. No, no, too easy. But to get to get the hypothesis, it took a few minutes. But you can leave the hypothesis. Okay, so it's not soluble into it. So now the imagine the drop. The drop is flowing into the air. The surfactant adsorbed at the interface, okay? Because you are above the CMC, so you have enough surfactant to cover. And then you hit the calcium. But the surfactant is not soluble in the calcium. So the only thing that can happen is a 2D solidification. 2D liquid solid transition at the surface. This is known in the field of surfactant. You can make a 2D solid layer. You have different phase transitions that are known. And this solid monomolecular layer is sufficiently strong to balance the vortices. That's it.
But do you think that it's not solid when it's in the air, the droplet?
No, because surfactant is not making solid layer in the air. It's not. But if you take surfactant into calcium at that concentration, you make a crystal instantaneously. You make sodium, we use sodium dodecyl sulfate, so you will make calcium sodium dodecyl.
Okay, because calcium cross-lines.
No, it's a precipitation, it's a salt. Common. A monolayer? No, it can't because we are below the CMC, so you can make.
Below. You said once you said above.
It can be a below, just
above,
about.
It's simply you have an air interface and then you have the air interface.
Yes.
When it's dropping.
So I will show you how it works by adding more surfactant below CMC, about CMC. That's basically the same. So you need that monolayer to be built up during the traveling in the air, and then when it hits the calcium, it makes a crust. Calcium can diffuse. You're in business. So now I show you how it works.
So how
we didn't make any direct characterization, but what we did is scan different surfactants, and it was working only when the surfactant was insoluble. So for me, as a kind of chemist, it's sufficient to be convinced. Yes? I mean, it could not be a crystal, it could be a gel, but it's solid. I mean, it's sufficiently tough to resist for the turbulence, that's all I can tell.
So you are speaking about the phase transition, the system before and after.
When it's in air, it's in a liquid state, that's known. Water, air, with sodium dodecyl sulfate made a liquid interface. Okay. This surfactant, when you put it in a calcium as a bulk system, it precipitates. Then the other result is if you let it go to the interface, drip it into the calcium solution, you see that the drop is protected from vortices. Then I'll let you get the conclusion you want.
Okay.
Yes, but if the surfactant is not crystallizing into the bath, this is not working. You need to have a surfactant which is insoluble into the calcium solution.
But insoluble and crystallized isn't the same thing.
No.
It could be it's just the repulsive barrier that protects the interface.
Insoluble and crystal, if you take a salt, if it's insoluble, it can make a crystal, it's a solid. What's the point? It forms this crust.
And then it comes back up. And what are the dynamics afterwards? This crust somehow.
Okay, so I show. You want to show. Thank you. Better? Okay, so let's move on a little bit. So you want to see that again, probably? Yeah. Okay, to be honest, could be a solid, could be a liquid crystal, it could be a gel, but it has an elastic modulus, that's it. Enough to fight the vortices, that's all I need. So again, this, it's important for you to have this in mind, so you see that it is really not mixing at the same time scale, it's quite surprising. You really see an elastic membrane that retracts this sort of fluid. Okay, so let's move on a bit. Okay, now.
Yeah, so the main thing is if you do see a membrane, at the end of the day, if you just look at this drop, you see floating on the surface a membrane, a solid membrane, or a membrane.
No, because when it goes, the surfactant is just a monolayer of surfactant. And you have your alginate below it that is going to gel. And at the end of
this is without that. This is just
just a drop. Okay.
So then you have, so as Paul was saying, things come back up, and you have this kind of
Yeah.
What happens next?
For that experiment, that's it.
But can you look it up? You should have a membrane then.
You should have a membrane. Yeah. But
you see it, you pick it up.
No. We didn't make the experiment because there is so many to do. I will show you, but we didn't really care if it was a membrane, a gel, a liquid crystal, or so. So now you are going to drip the co-flow of the inner and the thin membrane of alginate. You drip it into the calcium, and you have added a little bit of surfactant into the alginate membrane. Okay? And this, what is going on? Look at that. You make this beautiful thin membrane that build up right away. In a few milliseconds, you have something which is done. And here the membrane is something like 50 micron. But as I will show you, we can go down to 5 micron by reducing the diameter. OK. So now we can make a bit of a quantitative measurement and show that the thickness of the membrane, the minimum one, is really decreasing strongly with the SDS concentration. It is minimal. And if you go to above the CMC, then you reach the minimum thickness you can get. If you want to make them thinner, you have to make the drop smaller. I will show you that later. OK, you're convinced that the technology is there. And it's simple. And it's based on essentially water and water and water. Just a little bit of polymer. So to give you an idea of what is that material, now I take one of these capsules with this thin membrane. I deflate it by osmotic pumping, OK? And then I take this and put back in pure water. Of course, there is a little polymer inside that we put purposely, such that we can suck back the water. And I let you observe how this is re-swelling. So you will have a good feeling about what that material is. You'll see it's clearly something which is
a gel and a solid gel. So this takes 10 minutes, speed it up. So you see that now the by diffusion, osmotic pumping, so the capsule is re-swelling and is restoring its initial shape, and you have a nice balloon that you can work with and make different type of programs. What? Swelling? Yeah, of course. That's what we are using for probing the tissue and the ability to work against stress. Okay, so where we are, it's fun, but we are not quite yet to the growth of micro tissue. Why? Because to make a micro tissue, you need a smaller diameter such that diffusion is able to bring the nutrients faster than they are consumed by the growth. Otherwise, you are going to observe something which is linked to the necrosis because there is no food inside, and that's not what we want. So biologists know for long that you don't need any vascularization if you stay below 400 microns. That's above 400 microns that vascularizers start in the cancer growth. So we decided to scale down the production of this object and to make them much smaller, down to 300 microns, even smaller. Okay? But respecting exactly the same type of ideas. Okay. How we use it? Okay, so I have to tell you a little bit of boring thing about how it permeates through it. It's very simple. I will go quite fast on that. If you look at the leakage of some molecule out of these capsules, and you can take two different molecules, one is glucose and the other is dextran with a mass of 2 × 10⁴ grams per mole, so it starts to be a polymer which surveys a variation of at least 1 nanometer. And what you find a perfectly predictable leaking law, so I don't go through the equation, it's essentially trivial. From the fit, we get the diffusive coefficient, and we find basically the diffusive coefficient of this molecule in pure water. What does it mean? It means that through this membrane, glucose, dextran, they diffuse without knowing even that there is a membrane. That's pretty encouraging for what we want. But of course, if you take things that are bigger than this dextran, then you should be sensitive to the cutoff length scale of the gel. That's what we did. So now we take a dextran of 2 million grams per mole, so it starts to be a radius of gyration of about 7 or something nanometer. And what you see in that case is that the leakage is saturating at some level. You don't get everything out because this dextran is polydispersed, of course, as any big polymers that you buy to the supplier. Doesn't exist any that are really monodispersed at that size. And what you expect is the smaller skew distribution is going to leak, and you're going to keep encapsulated what is the bigger part. Okay? And then you go to the characterization of the size distribution of the polymers through dynamic light scattering, and then if you integrate that curve and you say, okay, this cutoff should correspond to what is left in, you get a very easily measurable length for the pores, which is about 10 microns or less. All right, so now we have the capsules. It's flow very nicely into water, any nutrients. So we are in business to look at some growth of microorganism. No tissue yet. We can learn about the growth of microorganisms that grow in a planktonic state. Planktonic means they are growing separately, like bacteria we were talking about yesterday, like yeast, like plankton that you have in the ocean. So that is the planktonic growth. They are separated and flow their life each separately. So then you are not worried about feeding inside the tissue by diffusion. So you can work out with a larger size as I was working with so far. And then you have the first experiment we obtained a few years ago with Nicola and my co-workers. We started with a few yeast encapsulated into this object. You see it's to several millimeter. This 17 hours after, you see that the capsule is full, it starts to be full with the yeast, and we discover that if you let it go, if it's smaller, the yeast can get to a point where it's almost densely packed. So into these things, because the chemical potential is conserved, because you can flow easily inside, the yeast can reach to full occupancy of the system. That's absolutely impossible to obtain if you let yeast growing into a batch, because they consume the nutrient, and then they stop growing because there is no more food, and there is some dirty things growing inside, and then it's not possible to reach more than 5 to 7%. Good question. So then, if you have
a bulky
gel, then you can't have a plankton growth.
You
cannot, because you are never going to reach this type of concentration at constant chemical potential. You will reach much, much less. Second reason, if you want to make what we are after, the real tissue, the mammalian cell into the gel, they never make any tissue. They don't connect together, they are just isolated into this gel, and they are losing the phenotype you are after. Okay, let's continue. Now we have to make them smaller. Too big, fun for biotech to screen maybe bacteria colony and so on, but we want them to go to tissue, so then we keep working on that, and Nicola and the students and so on, they come up with a jetting strategy. So you reduce the nodal size to about 100 micron.
So same thing with reuse technique, there's a...
It's all the same. Yeah, the dripping, of course, it's limited by the surface tension, the capillary length. It's below 1 millimeter. It's typically 1 millimeter, the minimum size. So by going to jet, then you have a thin jet that fragmentates through the radiant stability, and if you control that very well, you can end up with capsules that are much smaller, down to something like 150 micron, at a throughput rate which is quite huge. It can be 10 kilohertz, 10,000 capsules per second. So now we are in business to make a really high throughput method. So I let you look on that. You see, this is a jet. It's jetting at something like 2 meters per second here. And so all the technology is there, of course. I don't put that because it's detailed, but the technology is quite sharp to have everything working, meaning that there is not too much shear at the nozzle that damages the cell, to be sure that the jet is stable. And to make the stuff really working, what you need is to activate with the piezo vibration, piezoelectrical vibration. Here you have to act with a frequency which is a natural frequency for destabilizing the jet. So this is very known from the people who are in the field. I'm sure people know that better than I do. So if you have this jet, it's unstable. You want to break into drops. That's basically the radiant stability because you reduce the surface. But it's better to look at the wavelength with the camera, which is the most probable. So you record that, and when you design that wavelength very nice, you make an excitation at exactly the same wavelength, and then you produce droplets of all the same size.
When does the gel actually
gel? I come to this. I will tell you how it works.
So we don't need to worry about thin strands.
About?
Like what happens further to the right,
I guess. Further to the right?
Yeah,
there is some little satellite, but we don't really mind about that. You can get separated very easily. Other question? No, I don't think so. The piezo excitation is at the right frequency. Its excitation is something like 1.5 kHz. And we add also that very important, we add an electrical field in order to charge slightly each of the capsule, such that blow the cloud when they are. You know, essentially you're creating a cloud of capsules at that rate. But if you put a high voltage, then each of the capsules will grab a charge, and they are just separating very nicely from each other, and they don't coalesce until they hit the calcium bath. If you see the experiment, it's quite spectacular. You see when you put the field on, you have a nice cloud of this smoke that you can barely see with your eyes, and they are invading the calcium bath, and after a few seconds, you have a lot of this capsule all monodispersed. Okay, so I'm clear so far? I hope so. Okay, so that I switch, and now we go to some experiment. So now we have the capsule, we have everything. I skip every detail about composition, how you make the detail, the culture of this and so on. And now what I'm going to show you is what you can do with this object. As you understand, this is a capsule, the membrane capsule. This is the size of the scale bar, it's 100 microns, so it's a few hundred microns. And this is an elastic gel. It's an hydrogel. We know because we did measure, many other people did measure, it's an elastic material, exactly like rubber. Okay? We did measure the elastic modulus, so we know exactly how it's going to stretch with a certain pressure inside. So it's basic linear elasticity, so I don't go into this, but it's very simple. You can measure E by swaying the stuff with osmotic pressure, reducing the pressure, you have a slope, you get the elastic modulus. Okay, so I want to let you see how cancer cells grow into that, and when they hit the surrounding membrane, now they have to fight the deformation and they have to push against the wall in order to keep growing. Exactly what we are mimicking here is the environment of a cancer cell that try to find their space in the middle of healthy tissues. Okay. I'm sorry, some of the movies are really scary. The last one I prefer to tell. Okay, you have the time here. 12 hours, you see, the food comes freely, so the cells are happy, they can grow. Ah, now they hit the wall. Look at what's happened now. The membrane was stretched, the inside of the capsule changed dramatically, and the dynamic is maintained almost only on the rim of the capsules. This is the most spectacular thing we discovered, so I want to really make it clear. Question? So again, you see confluency, and then you see that some very, very large reorganization occurs in the middle. Membrane stretch, dynamic, again, very active on the surrounding. And okay, that's it for that experiment. So it's already a lot of information. I'll try to go into more detail about that. Okay, so what you discover is the following. When you hit the confluency, you are forming slowly a very large core of something that is totally different. And it's the results, that the nature that is governing that. Because there is a stress applied on the growing spheroids, then the response of the spheroid is to create in the middle a core. So a core, which is just a mixture of fibronectin and a few alive cells that are maintaining a solid state on which the growing ring can sit on and push on the membrane. And this is absolutely reproducible. You put the same stress, you end up with the same thing. So people will argue, oh, it's because there is no food. No, you can make a control. It's not a question of food, it's a question of stress. Okay, it's because there is a stress that the system responds by creating, by rearranging the middle, by making this network of fibronectin and a few alive cells that make these very dark pieces here. So here, if you look at the rate at which the radius of the capsule is growing as a function of time, you see that before confluency, it's a normal dividing rate, which is about 1.3 exactly. Then when you are stretching the membrane, then it's lowering by decay, one decay, that is factor 10. And when you break the membrane, I will show you an example where the membrane is thin enough so you can break it up, you recover the same growth rate. Yeah?
Is this all that makes in the middle, is that favorable for some reason for the
weaker
cells?
Say it again, is that favorable?
Why is it make a hole in the middle?
In the middle? It's not a hole, it's a tough material. Making some plastic material, polymerized fibronectin mixed with all the protein left by the dead cells.
Is there some reason that it does that?
In the middle?
Is that some response that's favorable?
If you if this will occur at the rim, you have no more growth. I don't know if it's a reason, but I see that as logic. Okay, so let me show you a few movies that are obtained with two photon confocal microscopy. So it's a quite high-tech method, but these people were so good, so they did these beautiful movies. So here we are staining everything else than the membrane. So this dye cannot go into the cells that are nicely alive, but they can go in everything which is a bulky material. And look what's happened. So it's a 2D, so it's a cut. Huh? You see what's happened. Essentially, in the middle, our assumption is again demonstrated. Here it's making a sort of soup in the middle, and the cell are active just on the rim. And this is a real, you know, collective behavior of some tissues that are facing a stress. And this is repeatable. You will find that with many different cancer cells.
What is the first thing about the cell, what do you imagine the computer?
Where?
What do you imagine the computer? Like the first thing you got, each cell has a first slice, or you get the...
It's a slice. It's a dye, I don't remember exactly the name, but it's a dye that can't go through the membrane.
Okay, so you just like to cover each membrane by some color.
So it will give you staining of everything which is accessible, but if you have to go through a membrane, you can't. Okay, and then we have another movie where we stain the membrane. So we'll see. Okay, so you see the dynamic is very active on the rim, right? Everybody sees it. So now I'm going to show you now what is the real dynamic of the cell at the surrounding, and I want you to observe how they change their shape, which at the end they change their phenotype. So this is also something very, very spectacular. Look at that. You see on the rim now, this cell become extremely motile, and they make very long lamellipodia, filipodia. It's absolutely unbelievable how they behave. It's such that they have changed their real phenotype to be active, so they try finally to escape. That's what they are doing. Okay, and in the middle, you see that there is nothing going on, as we said before. I really like that movie, it's frightening, right? Okay, so we are almost at the end of this first part because I have another part to tell, but it's very shortly. Okay, so now we can have a sort of a fancy way of imaging the same. So have a look at that, it's almost done. So we are just observing the cell inside at the surface. They are very different, flattened, lamellipodia, and so on. It's again a demonstration. And then I go to this. Okay, this is really the worst movie I have to show you. And it's probably something we are going to continue because it contains some information. So now we are going to let the stuff growing into a capsule which has a very thin wall. Thin, because we can set the thickness. So if we are right, it should grow, and at some point it should burst. I want to show you what's happened when it bursts. Ready? We're ready to go. Look at that. So it's growing, stretching. Ah, here is it, but poof, capsule is left over, and that's what you see. All the cells that we were observing at the surface, very active, these cells are ready to jump out and keep growing, dividing, and so on. Okay, so it was the real work of this student and Hugo Domejean. And of course, you see that there is a lot to do with these things. We have many directions, even too much.
So what is that bubble that forms?
This?
No. Before you pause, yes, what's that?
This, it's not a bubble, it's a cell which is taken out.
But it's huge.
No, but I don't understand what you mean. Okay, I guess something we miss here. Okay, I do it again and then explain you. So, you see this is the membrane, right?
Yeah, I see that.
Okay, what is going to happen is when it's burst, the membrane retracts at the initial size. And that's what you call the bubble. The capsule open up, And it's just an elastic material, so it retracts.
Yeah.
I didn't see it, I'm sorry.
Everybody sees what they want.
That's why it's good to show the movie.
So go to that point and stop it.
Yeah. Okay. Tell me when I stop. Here. Okay.
No.
Okay, now I want everybody to understand. This is the beginning of the hernia. It's breaking. It's making an hernia. Okay? And when it's open up, then it's expelled. Okay, so I can. What that? This. I have no idea. Sorry. That's a good point of giving talk, you know, in front of others. You learn something. For me, this is a cell which has been.
No, forget about that.
This? But this is a capsule. Yeah, it's like, you know, you have how to. It's like how to tell.
It's like pointing out
it expels the entire shaft.
Yeah.
What it does is, it makes a whole cylinder, it expels the whole cell, which then recloses the whole capsule. Which then
yeah, it's just so understood. It takes.
So right now, there's nothing encapsulating anything there.
No, that's a free serum now. And then the capsule is gone.
Yeah,
but
yeah, so then from there on, it just goes.
Goes. Yeah, the one on the rim are essentially the most active at the beginning. Yeah, we measure everything, so, of course. Okay, so if you want to measure the pressure at which it breaks.
No, I won't. There's a measurement time with the growth. You know, it should grow.
Yeah, so we want to know what pressure is arresting the growth. Is that the question? Okay, it's 10 kilopascal, between 5 and 10.
But I won't see the evolution. Does it keep growing inside?
It keeps growing inside slowly. So if you put the, yeah, to be honest, I don't put that too far because we are in this experiment we are done with the CT26 cell line. It's a cancer cell, so everything you learn about that at the end is not so interesting. So when we will be ready to do it with real human cancer cell, what we are on the way to do now, but there is a lot of procedure to do it. Then we are going to learn things that are really interesting. And what we want particularly is to put out of the biopsy of a human, to take each single cell of that biopsy into this capsule and to look at the diversity of the growth and ability to fight the stress. Because there is a lot of stories telling that maybe it's not a cancer, it's a one unique cancer cell which is causing damage. If you take, so I can give you some stories. If you take yeast, for example, nobody knew that yeast were able to reach confluency and push against an elastic shell. It does. We discover it. You make no yeast, pure yeast. So if you take some, so we have programmed using fibroblasts. Fibroblasts are able to fill up the space quite well. They don't stretch too much. Okay, that's where we are. But cancer cell, at least this one, are extremely active in pushing.
Okay, so it's pretty like once it's bursting the shell, the cancer cells spread much faster than.
Yeah. It's a very early stage of this, so it's just a proof of principle at that stage. Okay, I'm done, and I have some more time?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay,
so
good.
So this is how the cancer happens?
What? I'm not a doctor. I hope
it
has some similarities. It's a model. We can make something. We can make progress.
If you make a small thing, are the cells inside dead? And if you take a precancerous growth from human tissue, you have the same morphology where you have dead cells in the middle?
Exactly the same. this is demonstrated in that part of the interest of the paper. It's this is really the result of the pressure. The system built up this hard nodule in the middle such it can press against the rest of the world. This is how I understand it. So many things to do before, you know, you have to make the proteome to see what's going on, what's changing. So it's a real biology, so it's not all for us, I think. So we try to build, so to finish, again, the structure is the same. We are almost finishing to build an instrument which can produce this in a very easy way, and we expect to spread the instrument in a few hospitals and make people working with it, so that's the way we are going to make progress, not just by ourselves. Okay, so now I have another story.
Any questions
to
from this part?
Sorry?
So just asking if there are any more questions.
Yeah.
I mean, could you, is it possible to do a just, I mean, it should be able to do just pressure, but the fact that it's built in the last four means you could also observe stresses that are not meaningful.
Mm-hmm.
So is that part of what you're thinking, or?
Maybe, but I don't know. So far, I understand it what I showed you. I cannot tell more about that. I mean, it's related to how this core is growing in time. And if you look carefully, it's growing in a very bizarre way. It's not just homogeneous, it's more making a kind of fractal structure, like a growing gem inside. It's not so easy.
So if you don't think, if you frustrated the formation of that, like if you mix inside, so they're growing and then you mix it so they can't make.
I think so, yeah. I think so.
But
No. It would not be as efficient to split the membrane. That's my guess. Okay, we have to switch to something else. It's another funny story. So what I like to do in order to make a transition is to tell. First lecture, I was telling you about a method where you encapsulate cells, it was bacteria, but you could have been working with something else, such there is absolutely no crosstalk between the reservoirs. And it's the cells are totally enclosed with no communication with the rest of the world. Here we built a technology where they are entirely communicating with the rest of the world. You can feed them and set the chemical potential constant. Fine. Now I'm going to show you that it will be in the middle and use the fact that the reservoirs, the water drop into oil, can crosstalk together in order to measure something extremely precisely. That's what I want to make clear before ending this lecture. Okay, I move on. Osmotic relaxation induced by confined single cell breathing. So what I want to show you is by playing with osmotic flow, we can measure very precisely the breathing of a single cell, how much energy it uptake just to survive. So far, I don't know any measurement of that because it's too low amount to be analyzed, so it's not precise enough. This way, you'll see that it's straightforward. Okay, first experiment. I have a game for you. Again, there is a beer for the one who gets the answer. So you have two drops that are adhering one to the other. The external is oil. Two drops of water that are slightly adhesive. Okay, everybody understand that? They have a monolayer that slightly stick to the other and they make a contact angle. It's very basic. Fine. Okay, you have a big one, a small one. Just to make things clear, we put a little bit of dye into this one just to make them distinguishable. Okay, if I open up the movie now, what is going to happen? You have a big one, a small one, they are sticking together, they are filled with water. What should happen? So normally everybody say, oh, the small one is going to die into the big one because the Laplace pressure is bigger, it's a Kelvin experiment and so on. Then I will show you how it works. So this one should disappear, right? Look what happened. I know the big one is disappearing, okay? It's totally living. Okay, so of course it's not magical, it's very basic. So it's just to make you understanding that what is governing the flux of water is the chemical potential of the water inside the drop. So So of course, if there is a pressure due to curvatures, a Laplace pressure, it's adding up a little bit to the chemical potential, but not that much. Because the spheres here, the drop are about 10 microns, so the increase in pressure is zero. But by contrast, here we did put some salt in one of the drops. What drop contains salt? Of course, this one. It's sucking all the water of the one that contain a little bit of dye. But that experiment is a very, very basis of everything I'm going to tell in a few minutes after. What does it tell? It tells you that the water can permeate into this membrane very, very fast. And it tells you that the salt is not permeating at all. Okay, so that's really interesting. Because that means that every very water-soluble nutrient, that basically what it is, and nature is like this, the nutrients are very water-soluble. Sugar, amino acids, salt, whatever, they are basically water-soluble. So this means that if they are very soluble into water, as you see here, they are not going to go through this membrane, okay? But water does. And if we are going to probe the activity of cell such that they are uptaking some very water-soluble products and create some products that are less, slightly less soluble into the water, then we are in business because these products are going to diffuse fast out and we are going to read the uptake of food by the water transfer. And it's a beautiful a gift of the nature, because what it is about, I just simplify this. If you take one glucose molecule into the reservoir, okay, then if you want to equilibrate with the neighboring drop, you have to transfer all the surrounding water that correspond to one molecule. And if you are, for example, 10 or 20 grams per liter of glucose, okay, if you make the calculation, it takes a second. If you eat up one glucose molecule, you have to transfer a million of water molecules just to respect the osmotic equilibrium. Everybody understand that? So you have a huge amplification just given by pH. Okay, so let me show you a few things. So I have to rush, so I will go a little bit faster. So conclusion one, nutrients, salt, carbohydrate do not permeate, water permeate much faster. Fine. Another experiment. Now we put, look at that. We put ethanol in one of those drops, and we keep the glucose salt the same in each of them. And we put one more ethanol to start in one of them, and you see that there is no change in time. Conclusion, ethanol diffuses very fast, and it doesn't cause any osmotic mismatch. Okay, so again, so carbohydrate, salt, they are totally entrapped, but by contrast, ethanol diffuses extremely fast. And CO2, extremely fast also, it's totally soluble into oil. So then it smells very good. So then we can learn about cells that are uptaking very water-soluble products. They are excreting some stuff that are more oil-soluble. And because this is leaving the container very fast, then the only relaxation left is water permeation. And you can read exactly the amount of food which is taken by a cell. So I just go a little bit faster here because I have something like 10 minutes left. Product of the conclusion two, products of bioactivity, which are CO2, ethanol, or whatever products that the yeast or bacteria are making, are permeating much faster than the water. And so we are in business to build a technology and a method. So the requirement will be, at the time scale of the experiment, nutrients must not permeate. Products of the bioactivity, whatever they are, must permeate. And the consequence is the relaxation will be just from the water flux. All right? You are convinced or not? Not until you see the experiment, right? You are a pragmatic guy, I understand you. So I skip that and I show you the experiment first. I show you the experiment first because everyone wants to see it. Okay, this is it. So, here you have one yeast. Fine, to start. We built a large network of this drop and we have one yeast per roughly 10 droplets to be sure that the chemical potential of the reservoir is maintained. Only one yeast every 10 droplets. And you make a network of these droplets. You set everything right, and I will go back to a few details to explain. So now I will open up the movie and let you observe what's going on. You ready? So here I plot the volume of that drop that contains the yeast as a function of time, and let's see it. That's it. So it's dividing, look at that. It's eating up the sugar, look at the contraction. Okay, most of the water is gone just because you have to maintain the chemical potential the same. And the chemical potential is set by, where I am, I'm lost. Too sophisticated here, okay. Again, I will speed up to finish my story. You see, it's not a small effect, it's a huge effect. When we discovered that, we were just blown up. I didn't really thought it was a thing, I didn't think it was so efficient. And the volume restriction is absolutely enormous, so it's such a sensitive method that you can dream of measuring exactly the amount of food that a single cell is taking for maintaining our life. Now we are measuring the amount of food which is taken by a growing colony, but we are going to look a little bit further in detail. Okay, so I don't have enough time to give you detail about the technique. What you have to get in mind, you need to control the contact between the drop to make every permeation the same everywhere. So you have to maintain the contact angle the same, you have to measure the permeation, blah, 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 blah. And at the end, you can calculate everything and get the parameter you want out of this contraction curve. Okay, I finish with a few more things. So this is how a colony grows, I showed you already. And now, if you make the experiment, in parallel, you have many 600 colonies you can follow. What you find is a bunch of curves like this. You take the average curve, and it's so well matching the theory, no theory is there. You just have to write the diffusion equation saying that the substrate is eaten up by the growth of the colony. You get it, it's straightforward, works perfectly. Is there nothing to tell? And you can measure the yield of the biomass out of this curve. I switch to what I want, and this is more important because now we are going to work condition where it's not the glucose which is stopping the growth of the colony. It's not stopping because there is no glucose left. We put enough of glucose, but we deplete the system with some amino acids that are strictly necessary for cell division. So it should divide, and at some point there is no more of that magical chemical, and there is no more division. And you will see how the curve is changing its shape. Look at that. Okay, we start. The colony grow, and what you see, there is a total change in the behavior, a very linear regime here, exponential as we expect because the colony grow exponentially, and then there is no more division, and you have a nice linear regime. So we were happy with this, so we said, let's continue. Okay, you can fit, blah, blah. And then we said, let's take one cell, and you block that cell in the G1 of the mitosis. So by just changing the temperature, the biologists know how to do it, you just do what they say. And I will let you see now, that, I mean, this is the real conclusion of my talk. I want to convince you that the amplification due to the osmotic equilibrium, basically. Stuff I was explaining before, you have to transfer a million of molecules of water molecule for one sugar eaten up, will allow us to measure exactly how much this cell is going to eat as a function of time. You're ready? And now we are expecting a totally linear regime, right? Because there is no exponential growth of the colony. Yeah. Look at that. I really love that curve. Okay. It's eating. Look at the signal you get. I never saw a straight line like this, right? It's just a slope. You take the slope and you know exactly how this guy is eating per unit of time. And it's so sensitive because you know measuring is a radius of something like this with a computer and the image analysis, now it's so straightforward. Almost at the end, Now you can make this working and demonstrate that you can be sensitive to the number of chromosomes you have into these cells. If they are diploid as compared to tetraploid, they don't eat the same amount. The slope is not the same, and you correlate that with the size by sending that into the cytometer, and you find that they have different size, the scattering size is different. And we can correlate easily this with a few more of effort. You get a total linear relationship between the cell size, the number of chromosomes, and the amount of sugar they eat up per minute to maintain their life without any division. Basically normal, what with the new is the method and the numbers that are very precise. So I'm almost at the end. I will show you, I think I should speed up a bit. I will show you something that might interest you and us for the future, because I like these ideas to come up into technology, so you'll see what technology is going on. So here we took some strain of yeast that are commercial, and they are provided by a company called Soufflé. And you know, so far that's the way they characterize their strain. So +++ if they grow very fast, if they make a lot of alcohol, they make +++ and so on, less, more, and so on. That's the specification. So we took that strength and we put that into our device and we measure their signature into the in terms of osmotic activity. And we clearly find a correlation, the one which is not growing very well, not making a lot of ethanol, you see it's very far away here, and the one which is the best one for making wine, it creates alcohol right away, so you measure it. Fine, we are almost at the end, but that is probably the most important, and this is the work of Laurent, which is developing now in my lab this technology for spin-off. Now he was the hero of this work. But this is what is really telling you what we can do with this. So if you take different strain, and now into the drop, you don't put just sugar, the good sugar, the C6 sugar. You put a mixture of C6 and C5. You know the C5 is the sugar that normally not digested by yeast, normally. So that's why you make alcohol out of your grape or whatever, it's C6. But the dream is to digest C5 because that's biomass. Okay. So we put a mixture of them and we try now to see how much these strains that are commercial or some new strains that we collect somewhere are able to eat up this type of C5 sugar. So it's a xylose sugar. And we see that this one, the green one, can't, absolutely cannot eat this zero sugar. But the other strain, slowly they learn how to do it and they eat up most of it. So now we are making the following. We are making bank of diversity of the yeast. We are encapsulating them into these drops on a very large array to scan a very large number. And we try to grab the one, the single cell, able to digest this type of sugar. And because it reduces the size of the drop, we have a device that can filter the whole the system, and we get the small drop out, take out, and you have the strains which are able to resist the pressure you are acting on it, which is the bad food or the biomass that you want to digest. Okay, I think it's not far from the end. I will end up with this last movie because this is a generic technology. If you put bacteria instead of yeast, they are eating almost anything which is water soluble. And they are creating different metabolites, not exactly the same as the yeast, but you see that the general ideas are the same. And you will see that the curve might not be as simple to express in terms of mathematics, but basically you shrink and you can use that on a technological background. Okay, let's go. Coli eating up some miserable mixture, LB medium. Again, you know there is a curve which is slightly different, but a very significant shrink that will enable us to select for the bacteria if they are doing the job. So I'm done now.
Then if you
Yeah, probably, yes. There is no reason it should not, at least a little. I don't know how much, but probably, yes. So I'm done. I'm happy that you were trying to understand. What's here?
Mostly.
Mostly. Yes, go ahead for questions. Is there, yeah, no, I don't understand that. So you know, for yeast, they eat up sugar, they make ethanol and CO2, and a limit of ATP that is entropy in cell. So we know everything. So we can compute the curve and get the number. For bacteria, the metabolism is a little more complex, and there is diverse route. So I don't try to, we didn't try to understand that. But we were mostly interested in knowing if at the end the generic idea, which is nutrients are water soluble, exhaust molecules are less water soluble, you should have a contraction, it should be generic, and that's what we were trying to prove. Okay, thank you. That was a pleasure to